QSO Today, Episode 368, Mark Beckwith, N5OT. My thanks to ICOM America for sponsoring the QSO Today podcast. Welcome to the QSO Today podcast. I'm Eric Guth, 4Z1UG, your host. I demonstrate the diversity and relevance of the amateur radio hobby and its impact on society by interviewing ham radio operators, many of whom played vital roles in shaping our technology through the amateur radio hobby. And while many people might say, ham radio, do people still do that? This podcast demonstrates through in-depth interviews just how amazing, diverse, and dynamic the amateur radio hobby continues to be. The August edition of the QSO Today Virtual Ham Expo has ended. All of the presentations and their Q&A will be up on our Vimeo channel and from direct links on our completely searchable website within a few days. Presentation management, especially with 89 presentations, is an enormous task. So far, getting the Q&A videos from VFairs and splicing them on the presentations has been a bigger challenge. Please give Ben, Rachel, and I a little more time to finish all of them. These presentations are remarkable, and the Q&A makes them a valuable resource for ham radio. Mark Beckwith, N5OT, grew up in Southern California with Dave Bell, W6AQ, as his mentor in the 1970s. Dave opened a lot of doors to Mark, allowing Mark to build up his contesting and DX on-the-air skills. Mark was a professional opera singer for over 30 years, leading to some interesting conversation between us both on and off the QSO Today microphone. N5OT is my QSO Today. N5OT, this is Eric, 4Z1UG. Are you there, Mark?
4Z1UG, this is N5OT. I copy you loud and clear, Eric.
Mark, thanks for joining me on the QSO Today podcast. Can we start at the beginning of your ham radio story? When and how did it start for you?
Oh, sure thing. Before I got my license, several years, I had the occasion to discover a shortwave receiver at the home of my godparents. It did not have an antenna attached, I found out later, but I turned it on and was mesmerized by what I could hear on it. A couple of years after that, went to the public library and found a book on shortwave listening, digested it in total, and found that we had a shortwave receiver at our house, turned it on, hooked up a wire to it, and kind of the rest is history. One day I was tuning across the shortwave, and I heard who turned out to be a famous ham, Dave Bell, W6AQ. That was not his call at the time. He was having a contact, and I could hear him on the radio. I told my mom, and she said, you know, that must be Dave Bell who goes to our church. So later that week, I ran up to him after church and said, Mr. Bell, were you on the radio on Wednesday? And he said, why, yes, I was. And invited me over to look at his ham station, which is the beginning of this long journey. I got licensed. In those days, the novice class license was offered by the FCC. A person with a higher class license could send away for the exam and then administer it to a potential novice and then send all the results in, and the FCC would determine whether or not to issue the license. That happened for me in December of 1971. Coincidentally, about 50 years ago.
And what was the first call sign?
Oh, my call sign, WN6OTU. Back in those days, the novice call signs were 2x3s, and they had an N after the W, after the W in those days, 1971.
Were there any books besides the shortwave radio book or any books on electronics or radio that inspired you as a young ham?
Oh, as a young ham.
Or even before being a young ham.
Yeah, at the library, there was a ham radio book, and I really can't remember what it was called or even exactly who wrote it. It was not an ARRL publication, but I quickly got assimilated into ARRL culture, and I'm sure older hams handed down copies of old handbooks that they had upgraded, and so this was, you know, last year's copy or something, and I got a few of those when I was a teenager, and I just, you know, read them from cover to cover and could probably recite half of what was in them.
And how old were you when you got your first license?
I was 13 years old.
Were you electronically inclined, or you were just kind of radio inclined?
Well, I was not particularly electronically inclined. I fancied myself a model railroader, and in those days, I wouldn't describe that as electronics so much as electricity. And what's interesting is, for me, the prime motivation in ham radio has always been what I fondly refer to as the romance of the shortwaves. To me, it was much more interesting what I was hearing on the radio than how I was hearing it. So, you know, the incident with my my godparents' shortwave receiver happened several years before I got my license. So I spent quite a while listening to the likes of Radio Nederland, Radio Moscow, the BBC, that kind of stuff, and developed a really interesting perspective on world events as a 9, 10, 11-year-old than most of my peers in, you know, third, fourth, fifth grade. Current events was a regular topic growing up in school. You'd have to stand up in front of your class and report on it. And most people's go-to source was either the newspaper or the television. But I would bring anecdotes from the shortwave, which, you know, I like to say I was always funny that way.
What was the first rig?
Oh, my first rig. I made my first QSOs from a friend's house. He had a Heathkit DX40 and a Hammerland HQ170. But it was only a couple of months before my Elmer Dave Bell rounded up a Johnson Viking Adventurer transmitter and a Moro MBR5 receiver, which was very interesting, extremely obscure radio. But those transmitters and receivers are what where I cut my teeth on using the hand key on CW, making those novice contacts.
I think in 368 episodes, I've never had anybody have a Moro MBR5 receiver. What about that receiver do you remember the most?
It was specifically designed for mobile use. So to be installed in the car, it wasn't a big desk console kind of radio. It was very compact, used the miniaturized vacuum tubes. And when I received it, it came with, what do they call those multi-vibrators that you used to stick under the hood of your car, and they would take your DC and pretend to make it sort of into AC or something like that. But,
for the high voltage supply?
Yeah.
It had a vibrator power supply. You ran it on 12 volts in the shack, is that right?
No, I honestly don't remember, but I never used the multivibrator. The guy that gave it to me had a power supply that would power it, and I plugged in the power supply and then connected it to the radio, and that worked fine. It came with a matching transmitter that I never could get working, but I had the Johnson Viking Adventurer to get that job done.
Do you remember your first contact with a new rig?
Yeah, my first contact was with a ham whose call sign is K7JYE, and I still have his QSL card, but I can't remember his name off the top of my head. He was in Oregon, so I was in Pasadena, California area. So that was quite a haul for my first contact on CW, and we rag-chewed, and it set a precedent for me, that's for sure.
So let's go back to Dave Bell a little bit. Dave Bell was W6AQ. Can you talk a little bit about Dave Bell, not just as your mentor, but he was actually well known, and it's possible that there are people in the audience that are listening that have never heard of Dave Bell. So could you talk a little bit about who he was and what kind of impact he had on your life and your ham radio life?
Yeah, I'll do my best. Dave was a film and television producer in Hollywood. He originally grew up in Ohio and wound up in Hollywood because that's where the work was that he wanted to pursue. And he did that in the course of having a really successful film and television career, mostly doing documentaries, but not completely doing documentaries. He did a number of things. Well, Eric, I'm drawing a blank. Ben's going to have to work his magic here. in the course of that, he produced some of the earliest amateur radio documentaries for the ARRL that that I can remember, and I think that were ever made in the 60s. He would take actual film cameras and do that kind of stuff, and then mix together the old-fashioned way all of these products that were designed to market ham radio for the league. I think one was called This Is Ham Radio.
Right, with Walter Cronkite.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, for sure. And The Ham's Wide World, he made a number of short movies about ham radio in addition to his professional, you know, his day job. I remember putting up a tower at his house. We had probably 20 guys from the local club over there, and he strapped this camera onto the top of the tower pointing back down as we hinged it up from horizontal to vertical. And it, you know, it took like, you know, 25 minutes to set up the shot. And then a couple of years later, I saw it in one of his movies. It was a lot of fun.
What kind of influence did he have on you as a mentor?
Oh, well, Dave taught me about the magic of ham radio. That's for sure. He instilled in me my love for Henry amplifiers, because he was never without a 2K. And I have tried to reconstruct my childhood in that regard a number of times over the years. I have a very nice 2K at home now. He was a mover and shaker in all things front and center ham radio. You know, he was a big DXer. He was a very capable contester. He'd get on the air and work a lot of guys, a lot of people. Gosh, I think he took me to my first field day, the Pasadena Radio Club, back in those days. Well, I think it still is, W6KA. And then also instilled in me a love for getting on the air from unusual places, like outside of the country or mountaintops and things like that. And then later in life, he developed a real fanatical enthusiasm for QRP, getting on the air and operating with just a small amount of power.
You mentioned at the break something about an award that Dave had received. Can you just mention that again?
Dave Bell is listed as the only person to ever have been awarded the Lifetime Achievement Award from the American Radio Relay League.
That is something worth noting about Dave.
Did you ever go with him on any foreign de-expeditions?
No, I never went. I never went with him. He inspired me to do it, and I probably did a lot. I have done a lot more of it than he ever did. Gosh, trying to remember.
It's okay. More of it will come to you as we're talking here.
Okay.
Did ham radio play a part in the choices that you made for your education and career?
Oh, that's a good question. You know, I got really interested in the Caltech Amateur Radio Club, W6UE, when I was in high school, but that's because I was going there on Saturdays for kind of, you know, STEM before it was all the rage. The high school kids all over Southern California who had a science aptitude could be a part of this program at Caltech where you got these accelerated courses on Saturdays. And I was just loved astronomy and took all of their astronomy courses. In the course of doing that, I noticed the tower and antennas, and I tracked down the club station and became a part of that when I was a kid. So it's, you know, hard to say. I don't think that that ham radio particularly played a role in my career choices, and especially since I wound up as a professional musician. But there again, it's probably the romantic side of me that got hooked on shortwave radio as a kid that also made me pursue being a professional musician.
And now this message from ICOM America. Contest remotely or from the comfort of your own home. You heard that right. The three ICOM rigs that I'll discuss in this message can be remotely controlled using the optional RSBA1 software. And these days, given the high electronic noise and HOA restrictions, you might want to remotely operate your ICOM rig in a mountain cabin or a rural parcel from anywhere in the world over the internet. Now you can.
ICOM has the perfect base station ready for remote control action. The IC9700, the IC7610, and the IC7300 SDR transceivers are top of the line and are the first choice for contesters and DXers across the globe. Create your own band opening with the ICOM IC9700. This transceiver brings direct sampling to the UHF-VHF weak signal world. This all-mode transceiver is loaded with innovative features that are sure to keep you busy: faster processors, higher input gain, higher display resolution, and a cleaner signal. It has a 4.3-inch touchscreen color TFT LCD, real-time high-speed spectrum scope and waterfall display, smooth satellite operation with 99 satellite channels, dual watch operation, full duplex operation in satellite mode. The ICOM IC7610 is the SDR every ham wants. This high-performance SDR can pick out the faintest of signals even in the presence of stronger adjacent signals. The ICOM IC7610 is a direct sampling software-defined radio that will change the world's definition of an SDR transceiver. RF direct sampling system, 110 dB RMDR, independent dual receiver, dual digicell. Both the ICOM IC9700 and the IC7610 have Ethernet connections on their back panels to allow direct connection to your router without a server PC for remote control using the RSBA1 software. The ICOM IC7300 changed the way that entry-level HF is designed. This high-performance, innovative HF transceiver with its compact design will far exceed your expectations. RF direct sampling, 15 discrete bandpass filters, large 4.3-inch color touchscreen, real-time spectrum scope, SD memory card slot. Remote control can be made using a small computer or Raspberry Pi using the RSBA1 remote control software. This is amazing. So even if you live in an HOA or in the center of the city, where ham radio operation may not be ideal, ICOM has a remote base station solution with just the right rig to fit your requirements and budget. Please, when you visit your favorite dealer to purchase your ICOM rig, be sure to tell that dealer that you heard about it here on QSO Today. And now, back to our QSO. Where did you go to school to be a professional musician?
Well, that's a good story. I didn't go to school. I only applied to Caltech because I had been going there at that point for 5 or 6 years every week to take these courses, and that was where I was going to go. And when I applied, they actually turned me down, and the reason they gave was that I was too interested in the arts. Now, this is the mid-1970s, and this is in the days before people had figured out that being a well-rounded person probably had a greater net value than being a single-minded, single-focused individual. Forgive me if I pontificate a little bit, but the reality is I didn't apply to go anywhere else. And so in my senior year in high school, I found myself all dressed up with no place to go. So I went to junior college and lasted for about 5 months before I became a professional singer. And I did that for 30 years and had a fabulous career. As far as I'm concerned, nobody's ever heard of me, but I certainly kept clothes on my back, food on my table, and a roof over my head, and toured the country with opera companies and choirs and stuff like that, singing. And everywhere I went, I'd look up the hams to get lunch or something with a person that I might have worked on the radio in a contest.
Can you tell us an opera that you were in and what the part was?
Oh, sure. I was a member for 12 years of the America's Professional Gilbert and Sullivan Touring Company, Opera a la Carte. I was the principal comedian, and probably, you know, my favorite thing to do would have been the role of the Lord High Executioner, Coco, in The Mikado by Gilbert and Sullivan.
Okay, so I know that part well. I haven't played that part, but I've been in The Mikado. I personally never appreciated Gilbert and Sullivan until I was actually in Gilbert and Sullivan, and then you realize how brilliant they were. Did you do any Italian opera?
The opera was Gianni Schicchi, and, you know, the doctor is not a big role, but it was, I was going to say it was in Italian, but come to think of it, I'm sure we did it in English. That was at the Colorado Gilbert and Sullivan Festival, so they were doing Gianni Schicchi as a filler.
What's the current rig?
The current rig at N5OT at this moment, an ICOM IC746 Pro, one of two identical ones that I bought at the same time in 2005 when with a handful of other intrepid contest DXers, we decided to go away every year to operate the ARRL International DX Contest on CW. And this was the smallest, lightest rig that where you could have more than one of them and it wouldn't just be a huge baggage mess at the time. I have just acquired, of all things, two vintage Kenwood TS930s, which I plan to bring up to modern spec and use as my two radios at N5OT going forward.
The reason that you have two rigs is because you operate SO2R?
Yeah, there are a couple of reasons. One is a lot of contesters who try to do as well as they can, these days we use two radios at the same time. It, in the broad sense, it's called single operator two radio, SO2R, and it has evolved into quite a highly specialized feat. Some guys will call CQ on two different bands simultaneously, with the only restriction being that they cannot have more than one signal on the air at any given millisecond. And so everything is completely automated so that it CQs over here on this radio, but you're listening on that radio. And then it CQs on that radio, and then somebody answers your CQ on the first radio, and you write down their call sign, and then you transmit on that radio when you're listening on the other radio, and then somebody calls you over there, and it becomes a big juggling act. But the long and the short of it is QSO rate per hour records have fallen with this technique in a very impressive way. In February of this year, I write the results for the ARRL International DX contest, and we had a guy, Dan N6MJ, from Grand Cayman Islands. Well, actually, he was operating from his living room in Southern California via remote. He had a 420 QSOs in 1 hour on CW. And the best news of all is he found the time to eat a burrito while he was doing it. So that's what you do with two radios in a radio contest. But, you know, it is a good answer also is, you know, you like to have a backup. And so if you have a hot spare going, you don't lose any time if you blow something up by accident.
Well, I think it's amazing that he was able to get a burrito in the Grand Caymans. I'm just kidding.
Remember, he was in Southern California, and his wife went out for the burrito, so we're still trying to figure out if he was single operator, two radio, one wife, one burrito, or something like that. We're not quite sure where to classify him.
Well, you know, I've had other SO2R operators on before, and as you say, there appears to be quite a lot of automation involved in order to make sure that you don't transmit at the same time that you're switching antennas as needed. Do you have quite a fair amount of automation in your SO2R station?
You know, I do. However, most of my SO2R automation is from back in the early days of SO2R, like 2000, 2005, around in there. I quit doing it for a long time just because I decided to choose different priorities. But there is a lot of automation, and I still have it. Like, for instance, the top 10 devices DX doubler was one of the flagship pieces of gear you had to have in those days. And it's just a little box with a bunch of knobs and switches and jacks on it. And when you hook everything up, then automatically it just goes back and forth. Nowadays, it can be controlled by the software, and the software can be smart enough to know which radio you're on for what part of the exchange, and it'll know what to send next and all that stuff. So it is extremely automated. The other kind of elephant in the room for that is you got to have a lot of extensive filtering at your station to be able to like transmit on 20 meters while you're listening on 10 meters or 15 meters, because you're going to hear yourself transmitting on the other band unless you work really, really hard to minimize that kind of inner band interference in your own station.
Right. You might have cavity filters or tuned lines or things like this, right? Stubs.
Oh, there's a lot of different ways to do it. Conventional LC filters that are bandpass filters that only let that band through but attenuate everything that's not that band. Usually it's a combination of those that are very carefully tuned, being swept, you know, by frequency so that the curve is exactly where you want it and it attenuates just how you like. And then also coaxial stubs, which are a passive way of cutting down your specific harmonics on specific other bands that you specifically really don't want to hear at that time.
In 2014, you participated in the WRTC on the North American Team 9. Can you explain a little bit what WRTC is and how you became involved in it?
WRTC is the World Radio Sport Team Championship. It started, I forget when, in 1990, I'm pretty sure, and it has not happened every year. It's not something they do every year, and frankly, it would probably be unsustainable every year. It's fallen into a nice kind of cadence where it happens every 4 years, and it is sponsored by somebody somewhere in the world. It has moved since 1990. It's moved all over the world. And the 2014 one was actually held in Boston. The thing to know about WRTC is that every sponsor who picks up doing the WRTC is given the flexibility to kind of have the event be however they want. So there's not like a template, a WRTC template that everybody has to follow when they agree to sponsor the WRTC. There's a whole lot of individuality brought to the mix by the individual sponsors. And there has been a lot of variety and difference in how it's done. Sometimes it'll be, it's always a team. And I think it's always two operators. Sometimes each operator is on a separate radio on a separate band at the same time. Other times it's like a multi-single where they take turns operating one radio, but they're both allowed to listen. And it's to be perfectly honest, I could not recite all the different variations on that theme. But I know in Boston, we had two radios, two guys in a tent. We all had the exact same tower and antennas, the exact same power supply, and the sites, the individual sites for each of these stations were picked very, very carefully to do a reasonable job of ensuring similarity so that, you know, nobody would say, oh, well, that guy's station over there was better than my station because it's on top of a mountaintop or something like that.
What mode did you operate?
I operated both modes, and the other guy with me also operated both modes. I mean, the thing about WRTC for me is I have to be totally honest. We didn't do very well, and it's kind of embarrassing. But at the same time, it's one of those things where, you know, if you go to WRTC, you're kind of already at a level. But the craziest thing for me was this particular WRTC didn't require both of the operators to qualify for every given team. Only one operator had to qualify, and then the qualifying operator was allowed to pick the other operator for their team. And so I was not the qualifying operator. My good friend Mike W9RE qualified for WRTC and flattered me by asking if I would be his teammate, which I did. And so I went along with him and probably, you know, tanked all of his opportunities for doing well. So it's kind of, like I said, every single WRTC is done differently. And this was what we did in Boston in 2014. I had a great time and I enjoy going. And I'm sorry that that Mike and I didn't do better than we did, but hey, I'm not complaining.
And when you talk about both modes, you're referring to CW and single sideband, right?
Sorry, that was your question. Yeah, we both operated some CW and some sideband. And, you know, the operators are free to pick however they want to do that. You might have a guy who's a specialist at one mode and another. He has to be his teammate, somebody who's a specialist in the other mode. They can mix and match it however they want, from what I recall. But Mike and I, we both made some code contacts and we both made some voice contacts.
Now, you're now living in the Midwest, but it's my understanding that you are a founder of the Southern California Contest Club, the SCCC. Could you talk a little bit about that?
Oh, yeah. In the summer of 1975, a very gung-ho contester in Southern California named Peter Grillo, his call sign at the time, W6RTT, threw a party at his house. It was a barbecue. And the goal was to get all the people in Southern California who get on for contests to come and have a party. And at some point during the party, a contest club founding kind of broke out and we all said, hey, let's have a contest club. And so all of us present were founding members of the Southern California Contest Club, which started in 1975 in Pete Grillo's backyard. That was kind of on the heels of the Northern California Contest Club getting their start a few years before that and developing into a force that absolutely dominated the sweepstakes contest for a long time. I imagine a lot of us in Southern California looked at that and said, well, heck, if we got organized, we could beat them. And I don't know if that was the goal or not. Officially speaking, we did not create ourselves to enter contests as a club. We created ourselves to be a club of people interested in contesting and share tall tales and eat pizza and drink beer and stuff like that, which we did for a good long time.
For people who might be new to amateur radio, who might be looking for a club, what's the difference between a contest club and a regular ham radio club?
I will cite my own experience. When I was 13, I joined the Pasadena Radio Club, a bunch of hams who lived in Pasadena and the vicinity, and we would do ham radio stuff. There would be programs of general interest. There would be lecture demos. There was always field day where the club would mount a field day entry at a remote site on a mountaintop with generators and tents, and everybody would bring radios and antennas and towers and stuff. That's the kind of club, maybe you'd call it a general interest club, that frequently is part of a town. And it's more like a social gathering of a bunch of people interested in ham radio. A contest club, on the other hand, I think first you get interested in ham radio, and after you've been doing it for a while and you discover that you like to compete in radio competitions, then you become a contest operator. And a contest club is going to be made up of contest operators. It's kind of specialized. These are people who almost talk a different language about getting on the air and making contacts, because in a competitive event, the contacts are usually very short, very precise, and very accurate. And they're judged as such. And the shorter they are and the more of them you make, the better your score is going to be. And it's all about the score. For a lot of people, you ask a lot of contesters, they'll tell you they do it for fun, which is probably true. I know I have a great time when I do it. But at the Pasadena Radio Club, you know, we might provide communications for a foot race or other kind of, hospital fundraiser, what have you, that kind of thing. Contest clubs don't do that. They get on the air for contests and they light fires under each other and keep them motivated, and they share ideas. And they also band together to make multi-operator entries. Like if you have somebody has a big station and they can put a couple of transmitters on the air at the same time, they might try to get a crew of five or six other operators together to become a team like that and enter a category maybe called multi-operator two transmitter or something like that. Many contests offer those kinds of options.
Now, I grew up in Southern California as well. At the same time, we might even actually be close to the same age. But I don't remember any big contest stations. Were you involved in any big contest stations in Southern California in those days?
I was, yeah. Trying to remember, and I know I'm going to forget some of them. The contest station that I got invited to go be a contest operator at with a big group was K6RR. The gentleman who had the station is called Robert Roney, K6RR. I can't remember what his call was before that, but he became K6RR right about the time this was happening, and he built a big station on a mountaintop. You know, Southern California, it's I think in Orange County or maybe San Bernardino County. You know where Corona is? It's in the hills south of Corona.
Between Sierra Peak and Santiago Peak, along the ridge there somewhere.
Oh, yeah. In fact, Sierra Peak was just up the road like a mile. So that's where it was.
So he's sitting at about 3,000 feet on the ridge there. Yeah. I knew that area like the back of my hand. That's very interesting. I never saw the station there, but that's because I wasn't looking for it.
Yeah, I knew exactly where to look after a few years. And so you could drive California 71 or Interstate 15. And if you knew right where to look, you'd see something like 8 200-foot utility poles that supported really big rhombics, and then a number of towers with Yagis on them and other assorted. I think Bob had about 14 acres up there. But there were other stations, too. There was N6DX, which was in the hills south of Thousand Oaks, maybe.
There was a guy on Palos Verdes who also had a whole bunch of rhombics.
Oh, that was Don Wallace, W6AM. He's famous for that station and everything that he did to contribute to ham radio.
Were you ever at that station?
Never to operate the radio. I went to one open house, and I also attended a wake that was held there where, you know, every ham within 200 miles probably showed up and paid their respects.
They came to pay their respects to Don when Don passed away.
Correct. It was very interesting, too. I had developed such a rapport with Dave Bell at that point that some really kind of heavy hitters were trying to arrange for Dave to speak at Don's wake, and nobody could find Dave. And so they were all calling me wondering where Dave was. And I'm sure Dave was like on location shooting a movie. He did shoot a big movie. It was called, was The Long Walk Home, Alabama, at the time of in the mid. I don't remember. I guess we're going to have to look that one up.
That was kind of at the same time as Cheech and Chong. So when people were calling you up and you were saying, hey, where's Dave? You could have said, Dave's not here.
Oh, yeah. You know, I couldn't figure out who those guys were, but I knew Dave wasn't here or there.
For people from our generation, they might remember Cheech and Chong. They were comedians. Their famous sketch was, Dave's not here.
I remember that. It's a throwback to our reckless youths.
To our reckless youth, right? That's exactly right. You mentioned to me that you're involved with the Triple C, the Caribbean Contest Consortium, PJ2T. Can you talk a little bit about your involvement in that, and what is that exactly?
Oh, sure. It is a beloved pastime for many radio sport competitors to get on the air from places where they are rare. You know, it's like in a DX contest, you got your people in the United States and Canada, and they're all competing against each other to work the rest of the world or something like that. And it's those rest of the world stations that have the big pileups and work the huge numbers of contacts. It's a real rush, and when it bites you, it is hard to get unbit. So it is a common pastime for super serious radio sport operators to go somewhere accessible in the Caribbean or Central America, get on the air from there, and probably be like the only station in that country on the air that weekend. And there's, you know, thousands of other stations on the air that need to work you specifically. not only that, they need to work you on 160. They need to work you on 80, 40, 20, 15, 10. They got to get you on all bands. And so if you go there, it is a huge, exciting rush. The island of Curaçao in what used to be called the Netherlands Antilles, one of the chain of islands called the ABC Islands, which stands for Aruba, Bonaire, and Curaçao. Curaçao has a rich history of being on the air in contests, mostly because of an American guy that went down there and set up a life for himself and built a legendary hotel on the coast of the island called the Coral Cliff Hotel. His name was Chet Brandon, and he, the story has it, he built this hotel by hand. Like after work, he'd go down there with a shovel and dig some more foundation and pour some more concrete and stack some more rocks and all that kind of stuff. And that became an absolutely legendary destination for hams to go and get on the air. So just down the street, this little enclave of houses, like a neighborhood, started, and it was all built by Chet. And these houses, other hams might buy these houses or rent them and go get on the air from there. They get on the air from the hotel. Chet lived up the road on top of the ridge and that kind of thing. Anyway, this place became synonymous with a great place to go to get on the air and work thousands and thousands of contacts. One of the houses was bought by a guy, and I'm going to get my history messed up. I think it was John Thompson, W1BIH, maybe. And he put up a tower and just enjoyed that place as his DX destination for a long time. He became unable to travel as he grew older, and the house fell into disrepair and ruin and ultimately went up for sale. It got bought by a guy named Jeff, W0CG, Jeff Howard, who was looking for a place to establish a point of operations for contesters down in the Caribbean, called the Caribbean Contesting Consortium. To make a long story short, Jeff and his club were really, really successful in restoring the station and making it bigger than it ever was before, to the point where it became a going concern, a club where members could join or be invited to come down and operate in the Caribbean. The station was on the air for just every contest that is of note down there, to the point where in recent years, the towers started to show their age because they're right on the coral cliff, right adjacent to the pounding surf, and they take a beating from the salt air. I joined this club some time ago and have been going there for a long time too. They made me president, and my role was to try to do a capital campaign to develop the means to ensure that the station would continue for another couple of decades. We've done a pretty good job of doing that. There's been a lot of renewal, a lot of improvement, and it is just a fantastic destination. I stepped down as president a couple of months ago, and I felt like I'm leaving it in good hands. So that's the story there. We go down and get on from Papa Japan to Tango every opportunity we get. It's a great option for somebody who doesn't want to reinvent the wheel and find a place, arrange for licensing, arrange for a rental, carry a bunch of radio equipment down there, get it on the air, and find out what happens that way. So anybody who wants to talk about the Caribbean Contesting Consortium, they certainly know where to find us. We have a big web presence, and we're on the air literally.
And we'll put a link to that in the show notes page. Can that station be operated remotely now?
Oh, that's a good question. It can kind of be operated remotely. It's At the moment, remote access is for club members only, and it's not something that we rent out like a lot of remotes. It's not in the class of remotes that people have come to think of when they think of remotes. It's more like a tinkerer's paradise.
Let me take a quick break to tell you about my favorite amateur radio audio podcast, and that's the Ham Radio Workbench Podcast with George, KJ6VU, Jeremy, KF7IJZ, and it now includes Michael Walker, VA3MW, where they pursue topics, technology, and projects on their ham radio workbenches every 2 weeks. The group documents their projects and makes circuit boards available to their listeners. They have interesting guests and go in deep. Jeremy may complain about the overall length of the podcast, but friends, let me tell you that I could listen to it all day, and that's good. Even if you are a seasoned ham radio builder or just getting started, be sure to join George, Jeremy, and Mike now for the Ham Radio Workbench Podcast on every podcast player. Use the link on this week's show notes page by clicking on the image. A new way to show your support of the QSO Today podcast is to buy me a coffee. I consume gallons of coffee to create this weekly podcast. Invite me for coffee by pushing the yellow button, Buy Me a Coffee, on the QSO Today show notes page. And now back to our QSO Today. We met through the QSO Today Virtual Ham Expo, and at the time, you were actually representing CW Ops to the Expo, and you were instrumental in March in making sure that CW Ops was successful at the Expo when the Expo itself had a lot of technical problems, and I thank you for that post facto. But what is your involvement with CW Ops, and how did you become involved?
CW Ops is a really cool club of people who like CW. You get involved, or I should say, you become a member of CW Ops because somebody else who is a member of CW Ops decides that you're worthy of being sponsored and or nominated, I should say. And there are certain criteria that members of CW Ops need to meet. And honest to gosh, I am not fluent in what those criteria are, but you have to have been able to have conducted CW QSOs at a speed of 25 words per minute, I believe. The long and the short of it is, it's a great club of people who like CW. To the contrary of what I just said, where it might sound elitist, it's not really elitist. It's very welcoming. These are people who just enjoy CW so much. A friend of mine said, well, have you ever considered being in CW Ops? Can I nominate you? And I said, well, sure, because CW Ops sponsors these events every week. They say they're not contests, but if you listen to them, they kind of sound like contests. They're called the CWT, and they're an hour long. And now we have four of them on Wednesday at different times to favor different parts of the world. These events are just off the charts. I mean, when you look at 3830scores.com, where they show how many people have turned in a log for this event, we'll have like 425 operators get on the air for an hour. In the same hour, and that is a lot of QSOs to make, especially when you can work them on all the bands. So I was hearing these things on the air after I retired on Wednesdays during the day. It's just like, you don't expect to hear a contest on a Wednesday during the day. You're kind of puttering around the shop, and next thing you know, the radio's just exploding. So I figured out what they were, and I thought, these are neat, and I read the rules, and I could get into them even though I wasn't a member of CW Ops. So I got into them, and it was only a little while after that they said, hey, you want to be a member? And I said, well, sure. So that's how I became a member. And I am a dues paying rank and file member of the CW Operators Club, and am proud to say so. That's all that I do with the club. They did ask me to help with their team that did the QSO Today Virtual Ham Expo in March, which I did, and we had a grand time, and that's my story, and I'm sticking to it, Eric.
There's a lot of things we did that people remind me we did. But one of the things we did that was a lot of fun for CW Ops is that we took 20 tables in the main lounge after 5 p.m. Pacific time until 8 a.m. Sunday morning and made those CW Ops tables. And what was really cool about that was in the middle of the night, which is, you know, my day here, there were people all night long at those tables having conversations with each other, and it was really great. It showed that it was a big community, but also like a very nice and welcoming community. That's the first thing. The second thing is I took a CW Ops also runs CW Academy, and I took a course there in the spring, and it was absolutely terrific. So there's a lot going at CW Ops, and CW Academy is just amazingly well done.
Yeah, it's a first class operation, I would say for sure. I remember that you graciously allowed us to just commandeer a number of tables so that I think our goal was to seat up to 200 or something like that. We grabbed all these tables and put our names on them right when things were winding down for the evening, and the night just took off. And I stayed up all night because I was kind of one of the people being a host, and we just had the best time. And, you know, the tables had, I think, 8 chairs per table. And so we kind of broke up into little subgroups with special interests. One of them was at one point we had a whole pile of retired professional musicians. And we just sat around and talked shop and had a great time. But there were tons of good conversations going on. And the thing is, The way that you built that particular expo, Eric, we had a booth at the show itself where we had so much foot traffic. It was just uncanny. And I would kind of wander around looking at everybody else's booths. And I'd say that we did very well. We had lots and lots of people coming. And probably because we're a social club, and we weren't selling anything. We were not vendors, but we made a lot of friends, got a lot of people interested in CW, and particularly the CW Academy. I remember the lectures that we signed up for and gave on the speaker track. We had big crowds. We had like 320 in the audience for 2 of our really big talks, and that really warmed my heart to see that we could be so successful at a virtual ham expo brought on by a global pandemic.
What seems amazing about CW now is that it has more people doing it than in the history of CW.
Yeah, I have to agree with you. You know, back when you and I were youngsters, CW was required as one of the licensing requirements by the FCC. And we, you know, we had to do it. And some number of people realized they actually liked it and they kept doing it. And so there was a lot of CW activity in those days. But then it definitely dried up. And then it no longer became a requirement. And so new licensees didn't have to know the code. And I think what's happened, it's hard to second guess what's happened, but if I did have to guess, I'd say CW has become more of a kind of a hobbyist novelty that is kind of fun and quirky and interesting. It's no longer considered to be some sort of emergency communication requirement protocol thing like it used to be in the old days. And so people are doing it just for fun. But I think if you pile onto that, the average age of ham radio operators and how a lot of us are retiring now and spending more time on the radio, I was amazed just last Saturday morning to turn on the radio and the bands were just crawling with CW contacts. It was a popular weekend to be on the radio, that's for sure.
What do you think the greatest challenge is facing amateur radio now?
Oh, my goodness. Probably something like remaining pertinent to society. I have a friend who when he's not feeling charitable about the ARRL, he refers to it as the Amateur Radio Reenactment League, which conjures up you know, Civil War battlefield reenactment kind of things where a lot of people like to get out there and do that and put on the costumes and pretend it's the old days and stuff. But in order to stay relevant, shortwave radio, well, not just shortwave radio, it's all radio, isn't it? I'm showing my honest roots from my childhood. I'd say the future generations getting wrapped up in science and engineering that is radio centric, it's not going to go away. I mean, the need for what radio can do is not getting smaller. And I know that there are professional engineers who, when they're looking to recruit young people, ham radio operators have a leg up because ham radio operators understand communications. They know more than just the electronics they learned in school. They actually know what it takes to accomplish communication. And this is a real valuable asset in all kinds of electrical engineering. So I know that is, there's a bottomless pit of opportunity for young hams if they can put those pieces together. And I think it's incumbent on us old guys to do what we can to help move that forward. And the big challenge is, I don't think we're doing that good a job of it right now. We could do better. And there's a lot of potential that we could take advantage of. So the challenge is to take advantage of all that potential and get it moving. There's a lot of us later in life who really, really want to help.
What excites you the most about what's happening in amateur radio now?
You know what? It's there's this thing called FT8, which is it's like a double-edged sword. It's that thing that an old timer loves to hate, and then when they talk to all their old timer buddies, it turns out a lot of their old timer buddies are just getting involved and jumping in there. And you know, to somebody who has made analog QSOs with places all over the world for 50 years, it's like, why would you have computers just talk to each other like that? But then you step back and you look at the effect that it's having on new hams and young hams, and the fact that they are able to just make contacts, even though they live in a place where they can hardly put up any kind of a radio station. You got to admit, that's impressive, and the potential is mind-boggling. So, you know, I think those digital modes are pretty cool. I really do.
Yeah, I think they are too. And I think there seems to be a sense, at least government organizations are going to start exploring the use, or maybe this kind of use of HF, once again, so that it's not so dependent on infrastructures that are relatively fragile. So it's very possible that we'll actually see some of this technology that we're using actually translate perhaps into the public or the government sector. That's my thinking.
Oh, well, that's the story of ham radio. It seems like a lot of great innovations in electronics started with the amateurs. At least that's something we've taken a lot of credit for over the years, and at least some of it is true. I should say, Eric, that another thing that is a little more like getting on the air and talking to people analog style is the huge explosion in remote operations, kind of for the same reason. You know, if you have somebody who lives in a place where getting on the air just is really impossible, and that can be because of restriction on how they can use their property, or because they live in a high-rise apartment building in the middle of, you know, one of the noisiest cities in the world. And when by noise, of course, I mean RF noise. Those same folks who can get on FT8 and make a contact using a dipole on their balcony, if they have internet access, they can also link to a station that's somewhere that doesn't have those same kinds of drawbacks and get on the air and work people in more conventional ways that we think of, like voice and code. I think, well, I have lots of ideas for how remote can be used to move ham radio forward. But my ideas aren't well enough thought out that I could go into them and not sound like a loony bin at this point. But I think that it's going to come into its own, just the strides that remoting has made over the past 5 years are pretty breathtaking. And 5 years from now, we won't even recognize it again.
What advice would you give to newer returning hams to the hobby?
The advice I'd give to newer returning hams to the hobby, from my perspective, enjoy the romance. Radio is magic, and at the very core, that is what makes it a human thing for me. I enjoy the magic of finding what comes to my ears through these incredibly special means. It has never let me down. I've never grown tired of it. I've been enjoying being a two-way radio operator for 50 years, and before that, a shortwave listener. And I expect that I'll carry it all the way to the end of my life.
Well, I think, Mark, we believe the same thing. So I'm so happy to hear you end on that note. I want to thank you so much for joining me on the QSO Today podcast and wish you 73.
Well, thanks, Eric. 73 to you, and I'll look forward to talking down the road. Take care.
That concludes this episode of QSO Today. I hope that you enjoyed this QSO with Mark. Please be sure to check out the show notes that include links and information about the topics that we discussed. Go to www.qsotoday.com and put in N5OT in the search box at the top of the page. My thanks to ICOM America for its support of the QSO Today podcast. Please show your support of ICOM America by clicking on their banner in the show notes pages. You may notice that some of the episodes are transcribed into written text. If you'd like to sponsor this or any other episode into written text, please contact me. Support the QSO Today podcast by first joining the QSO Today email list by pressing the subscribe buttons on the show notes pages. I will not spam you or share your email address with anyone. Become a listener sponsor monthly or annually by clicking on the sponsor buttons on the show notes pages, or use my Amazon link before shopping at Amazon. Amazon gives me a small commission on your purchases while at the same time protecting your privacy. I'm grateful for any way that you show appreciation and support. It makes a big difference as I head towards episode 400. QSO Today is now available in the iHeartRadio, Spotify, YouTube, and a bunch of other online audio services, including the iTunes Store. Look on the right side of the show notes pages for a listing of these services. You can use the Amazon Echo and say, "Alicia, play the QSO Today podcast from TuneIn." My thanks to Ben Bresky, who edits every single show and allows both this host and my guest to sound brilliant. Thanks, Ben. Until next time, this is Eric, 4Z1UG, 73. The QSO Today podcast is a product of KEG Media, Inc., who is solely responsible for its content.